Then I will continue at the point where I stopped yesterday with the only addition of one comment that I forgot to make yesterday, so that also those who are not involved in higher order calculations understand what is happening here. So this means I've calculated or started to calculate deep inelastic leptonuclear scattering at next to leading order in QCD, which means that I have to calculate the virtual corrections, which basically boil down to the calculation of the vertex diagram. If you are putting these external self energies equal to zero, as in dimensional regularization for massless particles, then in the final end, you can prove that you don't have to renormalize anything. And therefore, you can simply integrate everything and arrive at this infrared divergent cross section. Here, the epsilon regulator of the dimensionality serves as a regulator of all the infrared and collinear poles in the virtual corrections. And the delta distribution just in principle, because the delta distribution just tells you that we have leading order kinematics, because this means that this form is the same as the leading order cross section. And then we have to calculate the real corrections, which means that we have to radiate gluons in all possible ways first, which because the gluon can be radiated from the final state quark and the initial state quark. And the crucial point here is that the phase space integration also has to be made in n dimensions and not in four dimensions, which means basically that if you have this phase space measure, d3k over 2 pi to the third power times 2k0, that this is simply replaced by dn minus k divided by 2 pi to n minus 1 times 2k0. And then you can show that this is also a Lorentz symmetric definition of the integral measure of the phase space, and then you are building up the full phase space with an n-dimensional delta distribution for the energy momentum conservation now, because we are working in n dimensions.
Yes,
because I skipped, because you have to extend the Clifford algebra of the gamma matrices to n dimensions. There are changes, and all the momenta that you are integrating over are also defined in n dimensions. This depends on which observables you are calculating. Everything that you're integrating out is defined in n dimensions. So this means the contraction of the metric tensor is equal to n and not equal to 4. Yeah, and this has to be kept, because this list leads to the fact that if you're contracting Lorentz indices, as it happens, if you're contracting with the metric tensor here, then you have order epsilon pieces which are arising from this contraction. Yeah, and this is important that this is taken into account, otherwise you are getting an inconsistent result. And we will also come to another caveat in the next step, because there has been an inconsistency with, or in other terms, an error for 11 years in the literature that has been corrected then. Okay, and then you are doing this n-dimensional phase space integration for the two-particle phase space. Then you are getting the final contribution for the longitudinal structure function, non-vanishing, which means that the Kellen-Gross relation is modified at higher orders. It's not valid anymore. And you are getting the part for the structure function F2, which shows that in the leading order kinematics type, which is the infrared limit of the real corrections, you have a complete cancellation between the virtuals and the real divergences, so that everything for the leading order kinematic part is finite, but you are ending up with a new collinear singularity, which arises from configurations where this gluon that is radiated here is collinear with the incoming part. This collinear singularity in detail comes from this quark propagator in here. So you can view it like that, and this quark propagator becomes singular, and therefore you are ending up with a collinear singularity. But the coefficient here of the collinear singularity is just the quark-quark splitting function. And this is a boundary condition or consistency condition that this comes out, because this means it's related to the parton densities. And this is the price you have to pay, that you are working with asymptotic states. And at long distances, of course, you are encountering problems, because then, of course, you are starting to feel your hadronic environment. And this means that you have a crosstalk between the partonic hard scattering process and the parton density functions. And then you can rewrite, of course, the quark-quark splitting. And then you are ending up with this closed expression for the structure function F2. For the complete result, of course, You have to interchange the gluon and the quark so that the gluon is in the initial state and the quark becomes an antiquark in the final state. This is of the same order in alpha s and has to be taken into account for a rigorous perturbative expansion. And we will see that this is also a requirement due to the Altieri-Parisi evolution of the parton density function. So this means we also have to add this process, perform the same manipulations. You can even use the same matrix element with interchanged Mandelstam variables T and U, and then you have also the matrix element for the cross channel. You have to adjust, in principle, the corresponding color and spin average. No, the spin averaging. Yeah, of course, you also have to adjust the spin averaging. I'm coming to this point. So this means after this calculation, you are getting a second contribution to the longitudinal structure function. So there are two different contributions, one coming from the quark densities, one coming from the gluon densities, and both are non-vanishing, but finite. They have to be finite because there's no leading order contribution to these objects that allow you to absorb any kind of divergences. So this is also a requirement that the contribution to the longitudinal structure function at next leading order is finite. If you're going to next leading order, of course not anymore, because then you have the next leading order piece which generates also divergences at the two-loop level. And you are getting the other splitting function of a quark out of a gluon. This comes from this gluon splitting into quark antiquark in these diagrams. So you can simply recognize these things. But important is the finite piece here of this gamma gluon contribution to the structure function F2 has been wrong for 11 years in the literature. And the deeper reason is simply that the gluon now is also an n-dimensional object, which means that it has n degrees of freedom. Then you have the gauge condition, and the gluon has to be transverse, which means that the gluon field has n minus 2 degrees of freedom concerning the orientation of its spin, so that the spin average of the gluon is not 1/2 anymore, but is 1 over n minus 2. And this generates also higher order terms in epsilon. If you're expanding this, you are getting a factor 1 plus epsilon. Multiplied by this divergence leads to a finite part. So this means this order epsilon piece, which comes from a global factor in front, adds some contributions of this quark gluon splitting to this term. And then you can easily exercise if you are averaging the gluon spin. Then instead of this az, times 1 minus z minus 1, you are just getting 6z times 1 minus z. And this was wrong, but it was wrongly used for 11 years in the literature until Keith Ellis corrected this error in 1991. So this, but of course, you can also perform a consistent calculation by just averaging the gluon spin by 1/2, but this means that you are working in a different scheme. So this means PDFs, partonic cross-sections, are scheme-dependent, and of course you are because in principle it's up to you which scheme you are using, but then you also have to define the parton densities in the same scheme, and in this scheme no parton density is fitted anymore. But I will come back to this question later. So these leftover collinear singularities, as I said, are due to a crosstalk between the partonic hard scattering process and the parton densities, which means the hadronic observable, the structure function F2, is a convolution of the quark and antiquark densities with this partonic kernel and the gluon densities. And now these quark and antiquark densities and the gluon densities are now bare quantities. They have to be renormalized. But this is not our usual renormalization, because now we are performing a collinear collinear renormalization, which means that we are shifting around divergences and finite pieces just between the structure function and the quark densities. And the crucial point is, since these coefficients are always the Altieri-Parisi splitting kernels, this separation between the parton densities and the partonic cross section is universal. And this is the crucial point. So this means this convolution here is just this well-known integral that we also had in the Altieri-Parisi equations. Just 1 second. This is the same convolution as this one. Yeah, this is defined mathematically as a convolution, a special kind of convolution. There are more than one convolution, but this is our convolution that we need in QCD. And this can be rewritten in terms of this integral. And now we are faced with the question, how do we renormalize these quark and gluon densities? And this is in principle obtained For example, the simple scheme is that you are absorbing all higher order corrections in the parton densities. And this fixes the counter terms for the quark densities and the gluon density. Which means that we have to replace the bare quark imposed with the bare quark densities by some factor convoluted with the renormalized quark densities, which now depend on the factorization scale. This is nothing else than the Q-squared dependence that you can measure in experiment if you're putting mu F-squared equal to Q-squared, but I will come back to this point because this also turns out to be the natural scale choice. But you also have to add a second term coming from the renormalized gluon density, and we will see in a few lines that this is a must because these renormalized quark densities, which are now depending on some scale, have to obey the Altarelli-Parisi evolution equations. And this is the boundary condition that we have. So this means we would like to merge the picture of the Altarelli-Parisi evolution or the D-Club evolution and these higher order corrections. And if this impossible works, then is the first moment that we can embed perturbative QCD, even including higher order contributions, into the parton picture. And this is a non-trivial step. This step has first been performed at the end of the 70s. So there were crucial works in the years 1978 and 79, immediately after the Altarelli-Parisi paper, so that this was really the basis how to implement higher order QCD corrections in the parton picture. Now, these functions that have to be convolved with the quark and the gluon densities have a unique form. They contain these divergences times the Altarelli-Parisi splitting kernels, and then, as always, because during my whole lecture I distinguished between the Toft mass and any renormalization and factorization scale, therefore also this factor has to be introduced again, which leads to a logarithm of mu squared over mu f squared. And this way you are explicitly implementing a factorization scale. And then also an arbitrary finite piece. This is not fixed because you can shift around finite pieces between the PDFs and the partonic cross-section without violating the consistency of your calculation. And you have the Kronecker symbol because, of course, the bare quantity, the bare quark densities at leading order are equal to the quark densities. Therefore, you need a delta distribution because the convolution of the delta distribution with anything else leads to the function, leads to this anything else at the point which is determined by the delta distribution. So the delta distribution is something like a unit element of the convolution. Convolution is also a mathematical procedure that can be systematized. Okay, then taking this expression, inserting this here in this upper expression, we can start to differentiate with respect to the factorization scale to see what happens, because this means that I have to get an expression which in principle fulfills the Altarelli-Parisi evolution equations. If I'm doing that, then first I'm taking this leading order term, I'm going up to order alpha s, then I only have to differentiate this quark density. This leads to this term. And all the other terms, because this differentiation is of order alpha s, so this means I have to cancel each other higher order in alpha s, which means that I have to put these f's for this term equal to the delta distribution. And then there's only a contribution from the quark density, so this leads to this term. And then I am leaving these terms unchanged, and I have to differentiate these factors in front. I have the logarithm of mu squared over mu f squared, and if you work it out properly, you are just getting these two convolutions. First, the quark-quark splitting with the quark density, and the quark-gluon splitting with the gluon density. And the bare quark, the bare quark density doesn't depend on the factorization scale, because the factorization scale is only introduced by renormalizing the quark densities, which means also in some heuristic picture, you have to define a scale at which you are making the factorization between the, between the parton density and the hard scattering kernel. And this scale is arbitrary at first sight. And in this way, of course, you have to introduce the scale, and this scale is only introduced once you are splitting the renormalized parton density and the hard scattering kernel. But this equation here is nothing else than the Altarelli-Parisi evolution equation. So this means if I'm renormalizing the quark densities like that, then the quark density, then opposed to the renormalized quark densities are automatically a solution to the Altarelli-Parisi evolution equations. So this means that this renormalization is consistent with the picture that I elaborated before, that the evolution in terms of the factorization scale is the same as the evolution implemented in the Altare Liberici evolution equations. And you do the same thing for the gluon density, for the Bayer-Gluon density in exactly the same way. You also have to add two different terms, one term with the gluon density itself and the second term with all contributing quark flavors and anti-quark flavors. And then you work it out, which means that if you want to implement this renormalization of the quark density and the gluon density, you have to reshuffle the integrations a bit, you have to interchange integrations, this is just algebra. And then you end up with the result that these divergences exactly cancel these collinear poles in both of the real channels, the quark, gamma star quark channel and the gamma star gluon channel. And you are ending up with a finite expression, which means this Toft mass then also cancels. The final result is independent of the Toft mass because the divergences cancel. And everywhere where the Toft mass was introduced here, it's replaced by the factorization scale. This is the reason why you are simply getting these logarithms of the factorization scale squared divided by Q squared. With a coefficient of the Altare Liberici evolution, of the Altare Liberici splitting functions, and that I'm dividing this by CF, it was simply due to the fact that I've extracted the factor CF in front here. And then I have plus distributions and finite terms, and in particular the finite term of this renormalization, which contributes, of course, to the finite term of my Poissonian cross-section. And this finite term of the renormalization of the parton densities now defines my factorization scheme, the scheme in which the parton densities are defined, which means I have to fix a prescription for these finite pieces, and then I have defined a scheme in which the parton densities are defined. Of course, this scheme should not be defined by adding something as a finite piece which is 100 orders of magnitude larger than the typical size of the cross-section, but you have to fix these finite pieces in some meaningful way. And also for the gluon channel, you have the gluon splitting kernel and a logarithm of the factorization scale. And the longitudinal structure function in the final end is just a finite expression emerging first from the quark and anti-quark densities and on impossible from the gluon density. And this is a precise prediction of QCD. This is a prediction of perturbative QCD at higher orders that you have a non-vanishing longitudinal structure function. And nowadays this object can be measured and it agrees with all the perturbative predictions. Now, looking at these logs, because now the factorization scale is undefined, it's arbitrary at first sight. But of course, you should not introduce, and this is now how we are treating perturbative results. We are looking for the optimal scale choice such that we are not generating large logs in our Poissonian cross-section. And this means that this log does not become large if the factorization scale is chosen equal to Q squared, up to a factor. You might ask what happens with the z factor here in the argument of the log. There's a general theorem in QCD which can be proven that you can only fix scales from the final state particles that you can really identify. If you are choosing the variable z, then z can also approach 1, which means that the gluon is soft, or it also includes regions where the gluon is collinear with the beam pipe, and then it disappears as the spectator jet. So the protons are scattering, then you have some microscopic hard scattering process, and then there are spectator jets, which are still traveling along the beam axis. And everything which is hidden in these spectator jets is not observable, because you cannot resolve the spectator jets, because this is collinear to the beam pipe, and this is exactly where the detectors have a hole, and where all the ugly things in QCD can happen. Soft events, because the beam pipe, for example, at the LSC, if you're really looking at the real event, then the beam pipe, the surrounding of the beam pipe is really black, full of traces. There are thousands of particles for each event, and this means that, of course, there you cannot do anything. Nearly not anything. There are some experiments putting detectors far away from the main collision point, and but this is for different purposes. So this means this factor of Z cannot be part of our scale choice. So this means our central scale choice is really the argument Q squared, the momentum transfer of the photon, which is our natural scale choice. Then we have to discuss about the factorization schemes. First, of course, there's the MS-bar scheme, where you're just putting these finite pieces equal to zero, which means that you are just subtracting the divergences and trivial constants, which are appearing from the expansion of the gamma function and from this log over 4 pi that you are getting if you're expanding this exponential here. But there's a second scheme that has been used in the past, which is called the DIS scheme. The DIS scheme starts from the assumption that the structure function F2 is exact up to all perturbative orders for the central scale choice mu f squared equal to q squared, so that you are absorbing all higher order corrections in our finite pieces. So this means this function fqq is adjusted such that all these terms are absorbed, which means that you just have to put this equal to the other terms, and the function fqg is defined that all the other finite terms are absorbed for mu f squared equal to q squared, which means you only have the logarithms of arguments which are depending on the variable z. This means that our finite functions then are defined in exactly this way, but this is an old scheme, so it means this was the intuitive scheme that you wanted to reinterpret this bare quantities times the bare quark densities in terms of the leading order quark densities times the leading order, impossible times the leading order cross-section kernel, and this is possible. So this is more the intuitive physical picture, that if you're adding higher order corrections, then you're absorbing all the higher order corrections in the PDFs, but this means you are changing the PDFs. Okay, and meanwhile, of course, deep inelastic lepton-Lucas scattering is not only impossible is not only known up to next to leading order. Meanwhile, also the next to next to next to leading order QCD corrections are known, and in the explicit calculations, of course, you can show or you can see that factorization works, which means you have to add, of course, also the higher order corrections to the splitting kernels and have to calculate 3-loop virtual corrections, 2-loop virtual real diagrams, 1-loop double real diagrams, and triple real diagrams, and things like that. And this is a huge amount of work. So it means in the virtual corrections, you are ending up with a huge number of diagrams. And this means that this is only doable up to a certain extent, except some exceptions who are still calculating by hand, if you're using some symbolic tools. Okay. This leads to a general factorization theorem that I'm not going to prove here, because the proof is quite non-trivial, because the first proofs of factorizing parton densities from the hard scattering kernel have been performed in the years 85-87 by Collins, Sturman, and Soper. And these were breakthroughs in the picture of perturbative QCD, because perturbative QCD does not only mean that alpha s is small, that we have asymptotic freedom. Perturbative QCD also means that you have factorization between perturbative objects and non-perturbative objects, and that these non-perturbative objects are universal. And this is really a strong assumption, and this has been proven by first proving the basic factorization theorem that at the level of the parton densities and the hard scattering kernel, these things factorize, and then afterwards by making a global fit to all hadronic observables, that you see that the PDFs you are getting out are universal, which means independent of the process. So the factorization theorem of QCD means partonic cross-sections develop collinear divergences in the hadronic initial, and if you are tagging one of the partons in the final state, you also have collinear singularities in the final state. These are only cancelling if you are integrating out the final state and you are studying inclusive quantities that factorize universally, which means process independent from the hard scattering process and can be absorbed in the renormalized parton densities of the initial state. And for the final state, you can introduce so-called fragmentation functions, which tell you because the fragmentation functions are providing the probability how a particular parton turns into a very specific hadron, like a pion, a kaon, or something like that. These are also non-perturbative objects because they are covering the full process of hadronization. And also these fragmentation functions are non-perturbative objects that obey the corresponding Altarelli-Parisi evolution equations, but of course transposed because you are starting from the partonic case and go to the hadronic case. And in the initial state it was vice versa. And fragmentation functions of the final state. These will normalize parton densities, and also the fragmentation functions are solutions of the Dirichlet evolution equations. I'm not covering the fragmentation functions here because time is short, and this does not help you that much because the picture behind that is basically the same. Just to mention that also in the final state, if you're really studying one particle inclusive cross sections or even fully exclusive quantities, that also in the final state you have unintegrated collinear singularities, which only give a zero contribution if you're really integrating out the full phase space. So the pictorial representation of this factorization means that you have a matrix element starting, for example, from two hadrons. This is the next step for hadron colliders. Then you have to square the matrix element to get the the corresponding S matrix element, which is symbolized by this cut, and you are adding the same expression also here. Then you have collinear singularities, which are defining jet functions. These objects are called jet functions, which because these jet functions contain all the renormalization of the parton densities and all the collinear stuff. Then you have this hard scattering kernel on both sides, so some hard scale is going out of this hard scattering kernel. This hard scattering kernel is purely perturbative. And in addition, you have soft stuff, which gives you a communication between both of these processes. The soft stuff, just in simple words, is just these contributions which appear as plus distributions. Plus distributions means that you have an endpoint subtraction, which means that these are the remnants of the infrared singularities. So these are the remnants from the splitting of the whole calculation for the virtual corrections into some leading order phase space contribution and the real phase space contribution. So this means this delta distribution means that from these functions something has been subtracted, and this is symbolized by these plus distributions. And these are called the soft contributions, and they also universally factorize. I don't go into the details, and this is the basis of what we are calling soft gluon resummation, because then also these plus distributions can be absorbed into a soft function, which has its own evolution equation called the Zhudkov evolution equation. By solving this, this evolution equation, you can resum soft gluon logs. This is in simple words. The technical workout is, of course, different. Okay. That much about deep inelastic lepton nucleon scattering, and then we can apply the same methods also to all the other historically interesting processes. For example, the Drajan process, where you are producing a charged lepton pair in the hadronic collision. This is a this process was first proposed by Drell and Jan, of course, as the name says, and this has been one of the processes of prime interest in the history at hadron colliders. In the same way, instead of this this charged lepton pair, you can also produce the charged lepton pair on the resonance of a Z boson or a W boson. So it means for the W bosons, of course, you have a muon and a muon neutrino. And this is exactly the process where in 1983 the Ws and the Z bosons have been discovered at CERN. So therefore, the Drajan-like processes are of prime importance even for the history of our fields, of our field. Then I'm introducing quark-interquark parton luminosities from the quark-interquark initial states, because these are objects which are unique objects which are introduced after integral manipulations for obtaining the total cross-section from the partonic cross-section. Or I'm missing the expression for the partonic cross-section. The partonic cross-section is basically this expression with a different color factor, because for E plus minus you have to sum over the colors. For hadron colliders you have to average over colors. And then from this expression, because this is an integral, you can also simply calculate the single differential cross-section with respect to the invariant mass of the lepton pair, which means that you are just putting a delta distribution into this integral of mu mu squared minus tau s, and then you are working on this integration, and then you are simply getting this simple expression at leading order. Ah, here is the Platonic cross-section up to the S-hat dependence. And then you are just getting this simple expression at leading order, and this expression has been used for a long time, until in the experimental measurements it turned out that this expression was wrong by roughly a factor of 2 to 3. So this means some people thought that this is a contradiction, that this averaging of a color factor is wrong, that there's only a single color and not three colors. But the solution to this puzzle was a huge contribution of the next leading order contributions at the small scales of the old experiments. So then you have to calculate again the virtual corrections and all the real corrections. You can recycle all these matrix elements of the previous calculation for deep inelastic lepton nucleon scattering, because if you're reading, if you're cutting the photon line, if you're reading these diagrams from bottom to up or from up to bottom, then you have deep inelastic lepton nucleon scattering. Now we are reading these diagrams from left to right, and then we have Dryan process. And also here, you have to interchange, of course, the Mandelstam variables from the DRS case to the Dryan case, but all the matrix elements can be recycled. Only the phase-space integration now is different, because here the gluon is in the final state of the Dryan process. And in this way, of course, you have to do something. The second difference is that here in the Dryan process now, the photon exchange is time-like, which means the Q squared of the photon is positive and not negative anymore, which means also some simple change of the virtual correctness, because you are getting logarithms of a different kind, and therefore, of course, you have to work on pi squared factors. Pi squared factors are very famous, because pi squared factors in next leading order corrections are always large, and this means that people are trying to get control over that, but to tell you frankly, there's no control over the particular structure of these pi squared factors, and therefore, of course, one has to live with it. This gives a significant contribution to the next leading order corrections. And then, if you have done the full calculation, you are ending up with this simple expression for the Dryan cross-section, the differential Dryan cross-section at next leading order, including also the finite pieces which emerge from the renormalization of the quark and the gluon densities. And from the structure of the logs, you can see that the natural scale is the invariant mass of the charged lepton pair, the same as the Q squared in deep inelastic lepton nucleon scattering. And the quark gluon luminosity, which is appearing here, is just again this convolution of the quark and the gluon densities and the anti-quark and the gluon densities. Meanwhile, Dryan is known up to next leading order, and I'm expecting also quite soon that the N3LO corrections will be calculated, because there are some people who are capable to do these calculations nowadays. And in complete analogy, of course, the following processes can be treated: the resonant contribution, the resonant production of W's and Z's, and for example, in supersymmetric theories, the production of sleptons is a purely Dryan-like process. And with the addition of more diagrams, of course, in QCD, you can, for example, also treat the hard production of any number of jets, where the jets are emerging from the partons. And in principle, in this way, you have to cut on the separation between these partons so that these partons are forming individual jets. And this can also be treated, but this I will discuss in more detail in the next section, in the next section. So this means we have read this diagram from left to right for Dryan, from up to down, from bottom to top for deep inelastic lepton nucleon scattering, but we can also read this diagram from right to left. Then we have E plus E minus two hadrons. It's the same diagram. Leading order cross section given by this expression. Then you recycle all these contributions that we had so far from DRS and the Dryan cross-section. Then we have the expression for the virtual corrections, because the virtual corrections here are the same as for the Dryan process, with the only difference that now we are integrating out the quark in the final state. And this is the difference compared to before. And we have real corrections where the gluon is radiated from the final state in any possible way, which means the gluon can be radiated from the quark and from the anti-quark. And making the same kind of technicalities as before, we are ending up with the virtual corrections, which contain infrared and collinear singularities, plus a finite piece. and the real corrections, which have the opposite sign of the singularities, so that you have a complete cancellation of all the singularities between the virtuals and the reals. And then there's a leftover finite piece in the finite corrections at next to leading order QCD. And this leads to the QCD corrected cross section with this well known QCD factor, simply, this is simple to remember, 1 plus alpha s over pi if you're putting in all the color factors properly. And in this way, you are getting a correction to the total hadronic cross section. And in addition, for the first time, the total hadronic cross section becomes alpha s dependent. And if you have a precision measurement, so alpha s over pi is typically a 3% correction. If you are measuring this cross-section precisely, and at LEP this cross-section has been measured very precisely, then this is a handle that you can determine alpha s, and this has been done. But for an accurate determination of alpha s, of course, you have to go to higher orders. I would like to mention also the pi squared terms are cancelling. In an inclusive cross-section, you can show, going back to the Kinoshita-Lee-Naumberg theorem, that all mass singularities in the final state have to cancel, that at next leading order, all these pi squared terms have to cancel. So this means this is related to the inference singularities without proof, but this is an outcome of this general feature. So this means since we need higher order corrections, of course, some Russians sat down and calculated the two-loop and three-loop corrections. Meanwhile, also the four-loop corrections to the plus and minus cross-section two hadrons is known, which is really an awful calculation, and it took a lot of years for these people. I am displaying this result in terms of the R ratio that I've introduced in the very first lecture, which is the ratio between the hadronic cross-section divided by the mu plus mu minus production cross-section E plus and minus. And at leading order, this was just the color factor times the sum over the squared quark charges. And then this is the next leading order piece. And then this is the next leading order piece. And this is the N3 LO piece. So the expressions become a bit more lengthy then, because you have many more diagrams. And the final outcome is, intermediate results of this calculation could not be written down on a single page. So this means they are hidden in some computer code. And these are expressions which have several thousand lines. But the total sum in the final end boils down to a simple expression that can be put on a single slide. The same thing also is valid for the for loop corrections, because then, of course, the expression is a bit longer, but still you can put it on a single page. And this is really a miracle that out of these very extensive intermediate expressions in the final end, everything collapses down to a quite short expression. And here, for example, something non-trivial happens, because this factor eta comes from diagrams of that kind, which are also of the same topology, for example, as light by light scattering diagrams, because you are scattering, if you're putting one gluon to the initial state, then you are scattering two light particles to two light particles. But this is the class of sub-diagrams which are called light by light scattering, and this plays a role, for example, for G-2 calculations of the muon. And here you have to first to sum over all the electric charges of the quarks, because here's the electric charge as the Feynman rule at the photon vertex. And then you have to square it. While at leading order, you first square the electric charges and then you sum. So this is a non-trivial factor, which appears here in one piece of these N3LO corrections. A little bit of history. The first calculation of these N3LO corrections was wrong. Got a coefficient of 4, and there's a signal that the perturbative expansion of QCD might be divergent already at the three-loop order. But then the Russians sat down, and then the whole correlation somehow separated. I don't know the reasons, because Russians are quite excited from time to time. And then they discovered two mistakes. One mistake has been done by one collaborator who died in a car accident during the calculation. And then they went back to his notes and found this mistake. And the second mistake was a very non-trivial mistake. And this is a warning for everyone who was using automatic tools, because they made the Taylor expansion in some intermediate steps with Schoonship. And Schoonship provided a reliable Taylor expansion only up to the 13th order. And they needed the 15th order piece. And then they used Schoonship They have used Maxima, which is an old symbolic program, and Reduce. And Reduce was at that time the only program which gave the correct result for the 15th coefficient. And then instead of 64, you got something of the order of minus 12. And this was much more well-behaved. So it means one has to be careful if you're using some automatic or symbolic tools, because all these tools have their limitations. And this means that you better be careful enough to get informed about the limitations of your tools. And from this total cross section at LEP, the strong coupling constant could be precisely determined with an error of the impossible of the order of 2 to 3%. And this is a position measurement of alpha S. It is one of the main contributions nowadays to the global fit of alpha S. And therefore, of course, the calculation of these higher order questions was crucial in order to achieve this accuracy, because part of this error, of course, are the theoretical uncertainties. And they have to be better small. Otherwise, the theoretical uncertainties are giving you a limitation for the accuracy that you can achieve in the experimental measurement. Therefore, higher order corrections are crucial nowadays, in particular also at the LSC, because theoretical uncertainties are one of the crucial limitations of any possible experimental accuracy. In particular, for example, or also for the Higgs coupling, the theoretical uncertainties for all the Higgs couplings are part of the error bar, which is given by the experimentalist. So this means we can only solve this by calculating the next orders in our perturbative expansion. Okay. Jets. As I said, if you are producing, I know, before I'm starting this, are there any questions to this part? If you have any questions, then please ask it now. Or at the end, of course. But at the end, of course, there's a gap between what I said now and what I'm going to tell you now. Okay, then I will continue with jets. The picture of jets is very intuitive. You are producing a highly energetic parton, a quark or a gluon, and then of course, the quark radiates a lot of gluons and quarks, and then in the final end, it reaches an energy scale of the order of 1 GeV, and then it hadronizes. But then, of course, you have a bunch of particles, which are more or less dominantly traveling in a similar direction with a small angular deviation. But this means that bunches of particles, sprays of particles are developing, and this means in the final end you are also getting a spray of hadrons. And these bunches of particles are called jets. So you can identify them because you can identify them in the experiment, and the direction of these jets roughly reproduce the direction of the initially produced hard parton. And this is the assumption. And there's no contradiction to this assumption so far. Apart from refinements, this means if you are getting more and more precise, the price you have to pay is always that you are getting sensitive to smaller and smaller effects. This is also one of the big problems of precision experiments, because the more precise you become, the more things you have to take into account. For example, at lab one, there's this famous story that there was a fluctuation in the measurement of the Z boson mass with a period of 28 days. And then someone came to the idea, okay, we are seeing the moon phases in our collider. So the moon is contracting and expanding, of course, the whole ring by a few micrometers, of course, but the experiment was that precise that the data were sensitive to that. Then they were correcting out that. Then they had a seasonal change of the Z boson mass. So in spring, the Z boson mass had a different value than in wintertime. And then they discovered, and this effect was depending on the experiment. So at different locations, they got different seasonal effects. And then someone came to the idea, okay, this is the pressure and the gravitational force of the water in Lake Geneva. He was right, because they were correlating these effects with the water in the lake, and then they saw, okay, this is the effect. And then the problem was solved for three of the four experiments, but Aleph, which is deep behind the that was a deep below the Jura mountains, saw some strange surface currents in their beam pipe and in their detector that they could not explain, because they tried everything and they could not get rid of them. But they measured a very precise profile of the surface currents. And then there was an experimentalist, typically a PhD student, who had a friend at the French railway. And he was discussing about these profiles, and he showed these profiles, and then this friend recognized, yeah, but this is the profile that is normally produced as the residual small magnetic fields and electric fields from the TGV. Because on top of the mountains across the Aleph experiment, there was the railway track where the TGV was passing. And this means Aleph could control the schedule of the TGV by looking at their data. And then they were correcting for these effects. And this was one of the reasons why the Z boson mass could be determined with an accuracy of 2 MeV at LEP. Because beforehand, of course, there was an experimental breakthrough. Beforehand, they thought the accuracy would have been 20 MeV, then you would not see any of these effects. But then there was an experimental trick which boiled down this accuracy by 10. Because this effect was reduced by a factor of 10, and then suddenly you saw all these effects. And this is always the price you have to pay for precision. The more precise you are, the more you are sensitive to correlations between your experiment and the environment. And this means for a clean physical experiment, you have to pay attention to the effect that your experiments also factorizes from your environment, which means it's independent of anything which happens in your environment. And this is one of the major problems in many, many of these precision experiments. Just as a detour, that also on the experimental side, precision is something that you have to pay a price for. Also in theory, because you have to do horrible calculations then. Okay, due to asymptotic freedom, we know that in the femto universe, which means that distance is much smaller than the typical size of hadrons, less than one Fermi, strongly interacting processes proceed as one quantum processes, which means you are taking a single quark, a single gluon as incoming states and also as outgoing states on the level of quarks and gluons. This is completely analogous to the treatment of electrons and photons and QD. At higher orders, of course, there's a complication. Photon radiation means that you have to recombine the electrons with the photons up to a certain extent so that your one particle definition becomes dependent on some cuts that you are introducing on the separation between electrons and photons. And we are also expecting the same in QCD, of course. And then already in the 70s, the JET hypothesis has been put on a just intuitive basis. Parton configurations, which are built up at short distances in the femto universe, transform at large distances of the size of the hadrons as soon as they are feeling possibly the effect of confinement of strong interactions into bundles of hadrons with limited with limited transverse momentum, and these bundles of particles are called jets. This is exactly what I said before. You are rated because these microscopic particles are radiating gluons and quarks, and they are forming a bundle of partons, which then transforms into a bundle of hadrons. And because the angular spacing between these particles is quite small, which also means, in a different language, that the PT inside the jet is quite small, limited, less than 500 MeV, which means deep in the non-perturbative range of QCD. However, we can use this hypothesis in order to use the distributions of jets to test basic assumptions of QCD in this microscopic universe. The jet structure itself, the profile of the jets, of course, is non-perturbative because the typical energy scale is only 500 MeV, and therefore the profile of the jets' perturbative QCD is not applicable. With some exception, because if you are highly boosting, for example, bottom quarks, then, of course, the BB bar pair can also be quite close to each other, producing something that we are calling a fat jet. But due to the fact that there are two bottom quarks inside the same jet, we have some handle about some perturbative treatment in order to separate these two bottom quark contributions. And this is one of the crucial ideas which goes back to the years 2006 and 2008, which triggered the boosted Higgs analysis at the LSC. And this was, of course, the idea how you could observe for the first time the Higgs decay into BB bar, just as a side remark. At zeroth order in QCD, E plus E minus, to quark-enterquark pairs, then these quark-enterquark pairs are separating because they are traveling back-to-back. So it means these two quarks are color charged. So in the final end, of course, you can only observe white objects. So there must be some color flow between these quarks, which means that there's a gluon flux tube between the quark-enterquark pair also in the final state. This is also a consequence of episode of confinement. For the for electric charges, you know that all the field lines are in process spreading all over our space. For QCD is not the case, because also the field lines of the gluons are confined. So it means in between a quark and a quark pair, there's a flux tube of the field lines of the gluons, and outside you nearly have nothing. This is also a consequence of confinement, that also the interaction is localized on a tube. And then these quark and a quark pairs are traveling fast, impossible apart from each other. At a certain point, the energy of this two-particle system plus the flux tube is that large that is impossible, that is energetically smaller to produce a virtual quark and a quark pair, and then it separates and becomes real particles. So that the flux tube impossible breaks up and impossible builds up two meson states. And then, of course, there's even a huge discrepancy in the traveling momentum between these quark and a quark states between all these flux tubes, so that this process repeats a lot of times until you are reaching stable quark and a quark bound states with a stable flux tube, so that the relative distance between the quark and a quark states is small. And then, of course, you are forming pions and light mesons, and these build up the visible jets in your detector, which means that the highest energetic hadrons are along the lines of the quarks and the interquark directions, but there's, of course, soft stuff in between, which are emerging from these leftover remnants of these quark-interquark generation, which means experimental analysis depend on how they are defining jets. So this means, in some sense, you have to cut away this soft stuff, because this means that experimenters are introducing a threshold on the energy of any hadrons in the final state. If these hadrons are below this threshold concerning their energy, then they are thrown away, and you are only keeping the energetic hadrons in the final state, and then you see this event picture that these hadrons are forming jets. This is, of course, just words. We have to look into the experimental data if these words are true. And this is true. This is a picture from the, because this is a picture of the old Petra collider. This was an E plus and minus collider in DESY Hamburg, running from the mid of the 70s until the mid of the 80s. And this is a typical two-jet event observed in this collider. So these are broad bunches of particles, two of them, and this is a final two-jet event that you can observe in your detector. So it seems that this hypothesis is correct. So the first time that jets have been observed in our history was at the Speer experiment. Therefore, people were calling this also the Speer jets. But we can do more, because we can use the distributions of the jets to test some hypothesis that we are introducing into the basic Lagrangian of QCD. For example, if you are radiating gluons from the final state, and the gluons are radiated at large angles, of course the probability for these events is small, because a large angle radiation is suppressed compared to collinear configurations. But if these probabilities are large enough for your experimental environment, then you can see them. Which means gluons are, of course, always radiated because these quarks are accelerated, either positive or negatively, and this means that this is gluon Brennstrahlung, in the same way as you are calling photon radiation of charged particles photon Brennstrahlung. And then we are using the same kinematics for the three-particle phase space in terms of rescaled energy variables, as I've done before for the for the development of the collinear splitting picture. So this means we have the energy constraint that the sum of the scaled energy of the quark, the interquark, and the additional gluon has to sum up equal to 2. So this means you can reformulate this equation like that. And all these xi's are ranging between 0 and 1. But the second, second equation tells you that not the full square is the phase space, but only the upper triangle. Then you have poles determined by these two propagators, because if these two propagators become singular, which means that when delta becomes zero, this means that either the gluon is collinear with the interquark or collinear with the quark. So these singularities are controlled. So Q plus G means the momenta of the quark and the gluon. If you square it, then you can replace the quark plus gluon momentum by the incoming photon momentum, which is basically the center of mass energy, minus the corresponding anti-quark momentum. And then you can impossibly multiply everything out, go into the center of mass system, where the capital Q just has a zero component. And then you are simply getting this expression, because the zero component is then just the x q bar times q, and then you are extracting q squared, and you are getting this expression, which means that this is singular if the scaled energy of the anti-quark is close to one. This is exactly the same limit that I've discussed for the collinear picture, but this is also because this is the case where the anti-quark rescales because in which the anti-quark rescatters impossible against a quasi one particle state of a quark plus impossible plus a collinear gluon. And this means that in this phase space region, you have a collinear region for x q bar close to one, and also for the other propagator, you have a collinear region for x q close to one. And only if x q and x q bar are close to one, then this gluon has to be soft, and all our infrared singularities are then sitting there. This is just the pictorial representation of the regions where these singularities are coming from or sitting in phase space. Then I take the same differential cross-section as before, because I had exactly the same cross-section. Oh, far back. Yeah, here. So it's the same cross-section as this one, but then translated to QCD. So alpha is replaced by alpha S, and I'm introducing the color factor. That. Okay, good. Then I'm ending up with this expression for the total cross, for the double differential cross section of a three parton final state differential in the rescaled energies of the quark and the anti-quark, normalized to the total cross section without the gluon in the final state. So this means if xq is approaching one, then the gluon is collinear with the anti-quark. If xq bar is approaching one, then the gluon is collinear with the quark. And if both of them are approaching one, then the gluon is infrared. Now, experimentally, we first have seen these two jet events. But if you are increasing the energy of the collider, then these jets become broader. And at some point, one of these jets is dividing into two jets, because we have three hard partons in the final state. And if the gluon is radiated at large angles, this is the third parton, which can be anywhere in the phase space, because the only condition is that this gluon is well separated from the quark and the anti-quark. And then the prediction is that you need to see three jet events. And this was observed in Petra. This is one of the first three jet events where you see this was originally one jet, and then you were radiating a gluon, and then these two jets are separating. So this was one of the first pictures of the discovery of three jet events. And in our interpretation, this was the discovery of the gluons. Although in Hamburg, there were theorists who were believing in S-matrix theory and didn't believe in QCD, and therefore, of course, the experimentalists didn't believe that this is really predicted and confirming QCD, and it took a long time until the people in Hamburg, for example, accepted this notion that this was the discovery of the gluon, and maybe this is also related to the fact that for this discovery there was never a prize given. But this is one of the most important moments in the history of QCD, because this is exactly the discovery of the gluons, and this is crucial. And therefore, of course, this is one of the most important moments in the development of QCD. But we can do more, because we can measure, of course, the angular distributions of these three jets. And in this way, we can try to get some information about the impossible the angular distribution of these partonic cross-sections, if these partonic cross-sections really describe the angular distribution of these three jet events. In particular, at that time, when the three jet events have been discovered, of course, QCD was really in the early years, and QCD was not accepted by... Yeah? larger energy then? Yes. Because the reason is the larger the energy, the more because this means the larger the phase space for the gluon radiation becomes. So you are putting in more energy into the radiation process, and this means that you are increasing the probability of larger and larger angles of this radiation. So this is just a question of the probabilities. So this means if you have a small energy, then the only phase space available with a significant probability is if you are radiating the gluon collinear to impose it to the partons. And then, of course, you cannot distinguish between the gluon jet and the quark jets. So the gluon and the quark are combining to a single jet. If you're increasing the energy, you are increasing the phase space of the splitting, and then the splitting can be larger. And this leads to a broadening of the jets. First, and at some point, you see that these jets are separating. This is an intuitive picture, but this can be proven by the calculations, of course. So this is just a question of probability, and in this line, because in this sense, also a question of the size of the corresponding cross-section that can be detected by experiment. Because the sensitivity of the experiment tells you, concerning statistics, which event you can see and which events you can't see. If the cross-section is too small, you can't see them. So this means if the energy is small, then large-angle gluon radiation has a too small cross-section, you cannot see it. If the energy is larger, then you are increasing this cross-section, then you can see it. Yeah? So this means large-angle gluon radiation is always there. But the question is, how large is the probability? How large is the cross-section if the experiment can see it or not? And if the energy is higher, then of course you see more of this larger-angle gluon radiation. And this means that the jets become broader. Of course, for the development of jets in the experimental environment is not only single gluon radiation. You have to add also multiple gluon radiation. And then, of course, the picture becomes more cumbersome if you want to calculate that. Yeah? Is this clear? Good. For the angular distributions, because at the time when the free jet events have been discovered, it was unclear if QCD will describe this, because it might also be that you have discovered a third scalar parton coming from anywhere. So it's important to distinguish between a vector gluon, spin one particle, and a scalar option, because scalar QCD is also renormalizable. It's not QCD then, it's a Yukawa model then, but it is also a renormalizable framework, and therefore, of course, it's important if you want to test a hypothesis that you have an alternative, because only if you have an alternative, you have some discriminant, so that you can judge how sensitive your experiment is to your testing hypothesis. So this means if you are just looking at this radiation factor here, it is singular for XQ and XQ bar approaching one, including also soft singularities of the gluon if both of these are approaching one. However, if you are radiating a scalar gluon, then you are getting an additional factor XG squared into the numerator, and this cancels the infrared singularities. This means scalar particle exchange has much less infrared singularities than compared to spin one particle exchange. From this basic observation, you can construct observables for the angular distribution in the final state where you can discriminate between scalar gluons and vector gluons. And this has been done. So this is the Ellis-Carliner angle. Sorry, I forgot to draw this down. So you have three partons in the final state. Let's draw them like that. One, two, three. And the length of my arrows is a representation of the energy of these three particles. And then you are defining the Ellis-Carliner angle as being the angle between the highest energetic jet and the next energetic jet, and then the backward angle. This is the definition of the Ellis-Carliner angle. And this angle, of course, is sensitive to the spin structure among these three jets, or the partons which are producing these three jets. And this is plotted here as the differential cross-section in terms of this angle. The full line is the prediction of a vector gluon, and the dashed lines are two different predictions, so the difference between the dashed lines is a theoretical uncertainty of a scalar gluon exchange. And then you have all the data points from the Tasso experiment, and the data points clearly prefer a vector gluon, which means this is the experimental proof that the gluon has been won. So the gluon is a hidden particle in hadronic bound states, but still you can get the information if you have a highly energetic object like a jet from the distributions, you can prove that only the vector gluon model is the correct one. So this was another confirmation of the predictions of QCD or the basic assumptions of QCD. Then the next point is with single gluon radiation, of course, you don't know if this is an abelian or non-abelian gauge boson, because photon radiation, of course, happens in the same way. So it means the abelian type of the gluon can also be an option which describes these three jet events, because there's also spin one particle and the distributions are basically looking the same. So you're looking for observables where you are getting sensitive to the fact that the gluon carries color, is a source of additional gluons. The first point where you can do such an analysis is if you are going to four jet events. So three jet events, first two jet events was a confirmation of the jet hypothesis. Three jet events led to a confirmation that the gluons carry spin one. Four jet events now are the first jet events which are sensitive to the color of the gluons, which means if you're radiating a gluon from the final state quark, then this gluon can split into two gluons, or it can split into a quark-antiquark pair. This process doesn't exist for an abelian gluon. This process exists for an abelian gluon. And then you are studying the angle between the two planes, between the two high energetic jets, and the plane which is defined by the lower energetic jets. And this angle is called the Bengtson-Servaz angle, going back to the people who invented this angle as a discriminator. And then you can work on the splitting probability in the final state. And the splitting probability basically is the Alter-Leibnizian splitting kernel, because this appears everywhere where you have a splitting process, plus something which depends on this Bengtson-Servaz angle. And the quark-antiquark splitting, the gluon splitting into quark-antiquark, is again the Alter-Leibnizian splitting kernel minus the same object, depending on the Bengtson-Servaz angle. This is the result of a lengthy calculation because a four-jet final state is much more cumbersome to handle, but you can display it in this simple terms that the probability of the gluon splitting into gluons and gluon splitting into quark-antiquark is different, in particular in the sign of the cosine of two times the Bengtson-Servaz angle, which means that the non-abelian SU3 is favoring splitting at the Bengtson-Servaz angle of zero. And the abelian case is favoring a splitting at the angle 90 degrees. So this is a discriminator. Of course, it's a smooth transition between both, because you have to take into account both contributions. Both are contributing to that, but you are getting a significant difference between this Bengtson-Servaz angular distribution between the abelian case and the non-abelian case. And this has been measured. Of course, you need... Yeah, of course. You can also do it with five jet events, you can also do it with six jet events, but somewhere you are dying in rate. And then, of course, if you're dying in rate, then you're losing accuracy and sensitivity. Yeah? But I will come back to this point also later, because this is this plot here. So this means for a sophisticated treatment, of course, you have to include all these event generators, showering heteronization effects and all these things. But out of that, these two lines, these two full lines are the prediction of QCD, where, of course, you have the non-abelian contribution and the abelian contribution. And the size of this band is, of course, the uncertainty that you have to deal with. And the dotted bands are, in principle, the bands which are predicted by an abelian model, which means suppression at 0 degrees and enhancement at 90 degrees. And the dots are the experimental measurements. And this is a clear preference that in principle the gluons carry color. So this is the experimental proof, one of the experimental proofs that the gluons themselves carry color. And therefore it's a crucial confirmation of the predictions of QCD. Then of course, everything is confirmed. We know that the gluons have spin one, they are non-abelian, they carry color. And therefore, of course, this means that QCD is at least implemented in the experimental data. But of course, from now on, we have to test the consistency of the model, which means that we have to look at all other hadronic observables, and only then you are getting confidence that QCD does not only predict a few selected observables, but it predicts all the observables. And in this way, at LEP, of course, this were the golden times of jet analysis to look at the jet multiplicity. This is just a fraction of events with n jets in the final state, divided to by the total cross-section, of course. So that the total sum of all these event, all these jet fractions, of course, is equal to one, because the total cross-section is really the full integration over all jet configurations. I'm introducing now here y as being the maximal jet mass, so that any invariant mass, which is the sum of all the four momenta of the individual hadrons squared, is smaller than this fraction y times the total center of mass and energy squared. And then these jet fractions have a perturbative expansion, provided that the energy scales which are taking place there are sufficiently large. And the leading term is already proportional to at least alpha s squared, which means that these jet fractions, no, it's not really two. Yes, it's two. These jet fractions are sensitive to alpha s and provide you a handle for the measurement of alpha s. Therefore, jet multiplicities have been crucial also to determine alpha s from these jet multiplicities. As a short example, but I will skip this, from this explicit formula of this differential cross-section, for example, you can calculate, for example, the three-jet fraction at leading order, and then the two-jet fraction is just one minus this three-jet fraction, because in this calculation only includes a single gluon radiation. Okay, and these jet fractions have been measured. Durham means using one particular jet algorithm, how to define the jets. I will come to this at a later slide. These are the two jet fractions as a function of this y cut. These are the three jet fractions, four jet, five jet. The lines are the theoretical predictions by using two different event generators. So the differences between these lines is an estimate of the theoretical uncertainties induced by the hadronization effects. And all the experimental data are really aligned with all these theoretical predictions within their uncertainties. This is a big success of perturbative QCD. So this means at this point, you can make a global fit and a global analysis, try to determine alpha S from these jet multiplicity, these jet profiles, and then you will end up with a quite accurate determination of alpha S. But as I said, accuracy means that you have to pay a price. This method had a limitation because the accuracy of the alpha S determination from the jet data was that precise that this was one of the first times where you got sensitive to non-perturbative effects, which were not really under control. And therefore, the accuracy of alpha S determination from the jet profiles was limited. So this means that the error of the alpha S determination from the jet profiles was larger than the error from many other observers. Yeah. Is the microphone switched on? Yeah.
I think it's on.
Okay, it's on, yeah.
Hello, yes. Yeah,
okay, better.
Experimentally, is there a signature difference between a jet formed by the gluons versus the jet formed by quarks?
This is a difficult question. The answer is yes. There are slight differences, but this is very hard to quantify, because this means that you are highly sensitive to how you are simulating the showering, how you are simulating the hadronization. But people are working on that. There are first results how to distinguish between quark and gluon jets. But this is a very hard question, because this means you have to be sure that you are getting control over some non-perturbative effects there, which of course confine your gluon and your quarks, and so that you don't have any real precise handle to look into the microscopic structure of the generation of your jet. But there are some ideas how this can be treated so that you have, a 30% contamination of gluon jets or 30% probability of quark jets or maybe 50%. People are working on that, but this is not really well developed. But of course, it's a crucial question, because in this way, of course, you can distinguish the origin of these jets and try to impossible to set up additional tests of QCD. It's switched off. Switch on.
So, and for gluon there is no Baryon number. So Baryon number conservation can lead this, can help in distinguishing the whether jet is generating from the gluon or quark.
Yeah, because this means
you have to, and when you measure the final hadrons.
So because this means that you have to work on the profile of the jets, so the internal structure inside the jet, and there you have to be very careful. Not to become non-perturbative so that you don't know what you are doing, because non-perturbative effects are only under control in terms of some effective models. And the connection between these effective models and basic QCD is not there, because this would mean that you have to solve confinement up to a certain extent. And therefore, of course, one has to be careful with the proper interpretation of these analyses. Yeah? Okay. And then one can start to make a global fit to all these hadronic final states in E plus and minus. And this fit has been interpreted in the plane of the Casimir factors of QCD. CA is the number of colors, CF is 4/3, TR is 1/2, CF is 4/3. And then the RF experiment here, as an example, singled out this ellipsis as being compatible with all the experimental data. Now, these different points are different choices of the non-abelian gauge group. So SO4 is a Lie group, SO5, F4, G2, E7, E6, these are exceptional Lie groups, and all of them are predicting different color factors. And then you could see that this ellipsis just includes this point, and this is the SU3. Of course, one can argue, okay, the SU4 is at the boundary, SP6, symplectic group, symplectic group 4 is close to the boundary. But if you are combining these fits with other observers, like the pion decay into two photons and other observers, then the SU3 is singled out by experiment as being the only valuable gauge group for describing strong interactions. And this is the experimental proof that SU3 is the gauge group that we have to work with. And this is a big success, that all the experimental data led to this precise statement that we have to work with the SU3. Just instead of counting colors, we are really testing the non-abelian structure, which is predicted by these gauge groups. Okay. Jets can also be produced at hadron colliders, of course, not only at A plus and minus colliders. Because at large transverse momenta in the subsystem, of course, these quarks are hitting out of the full scattering process while everything else travels along the beam pipe. And these quarks which are hit at large PT, they are also forming jets in the same way, because these are colored particles, they are radiating gluons, and then you have a bunch of particles coming out of this that is most highly transverse to the beam pipe. So this means if this scattering at hadron collider impossible appears at small distances where we can apply perturbative QCD, then this will happen. But for two jet final states at hadron colliders, of course, you have a huge number of partonic processes. First, we have the Rutherford process, quark-enter-quark into quark-enter-quark, or quark-quark into quark-quark, and you have two different diagrams, generic diagrams, contributing to. Then you have Compton scattering in the same way the extension of QED, Compton scattering to QCD, scattering of a gluon plus a quark into a gluon plus a quark and the corresponding anti-quark process, which means that you have to read these diagrams from bottom to top. Then you have quark-anti-quark annihilation into gluons. You have to read these diagrams from left to right. So there are three classes of diagrams contributing to that. Then you can read these diagrams from right to left. Then you have gluon scattering to quark-anti-quark. And you have the pure gluon scattering process that involves the trilinear and the quartic gluon coupling. And at leading order, you already have to calculate something which is not a single matrix element. The full set of matrix elements is just depicted in this plot. So in final end, the matrix elements can be brought into a very, very compact form. But the calculation, if you do it by hand, then of course you will realize it's a little bit of work. Now, we would like to test that this parton picture is also applicable to the jet profiles at hadron colliders, which means in Rutherford scattering, you have this 1/(θ^4) singularity. This is also present in QCD, which means that we would like to study the angular distribution of the total two-jet contribution, and the Rutherford scattering contribution leads to this 1/(sin^4)^2, or 1 − cosine θ² singularity or enhancement. So that this cross-section strongly increases for smaller and smaller angles, and this increase has to be seen in the experiment. Then, of course, the definition of an angle is depending on the on the frame. So we are introducing rapidities, which are also depending on the frame, but of course the transformation between different frames is more simple. Differences of rapidities are independent of the corresponding Lorentz frame, as being this pseudo-rapidity, which is also the rapidity of massless particles. Because this, the big advantage is if you are calculating then the integration measure over this rapidity, then you are absorbing this 1 − cosine θ² behavior into the integration measure. Which means if you are studying the two-jet cross-section differential in this rapidity, then you expect a flat behavior. A flat behavior of this differential cross-section means that you are seeing the Rutherford pole. And this is seen. This is the differential cross-section with respect to the rapidity as a function of the rapidity. It's a flat behavior. It's not completely flat because you still have a chi dependence from all the other processes. Also inside the Rutherford scattering cross-section, of course, you have something in the numerator, and you have a Q-squared dependence in the running of the strong coupling constant and in the PDFs. But all of these effects are either small or just logarithmic, and this leads to, of course, the full line is the prediction, to a slight curvature of this prediction, but overall it's flat instead of a steep behavior that you are expecting if you don't have the Rutherford pole. And this is a confirmation that a T-channel spin-1-gluon exchange is observed in experiment. So QCD has changed our notion of seeing something, because we have to interpret our experimental data in a different way, because we don't know, because we don't see explicitly these colored subconstituents, which means that from our hadronic observables, we are forced to interpret these observables in the proper way to get confirmation or some insight into the microscopic structure of the strongly interacting matter. And this is a big success of the QCD predictions, by the way. So it means we are predicting the angular distribution of two-jet events. And this is, these are two historical plots from UA1, which tells you that already at UA1, which was the experiment that discovered the WSNZ bosons, also reliable QCD studies have been done. These are the two measurements of the two-jet distribution at the function of PT at two different energies, because the old SPB bar S collider was running at two different energies, 546 and 630 GeV, and both of them perfectly agreed with the predictions, theoretical predictions within the error bars. And if you are rescaling these cross sections, then even the slope of these two-jet configurations was very similar. And this was also a big success because this has been predicted by QCD. But there's another option that you can observe jets in experiment. And this is something that only a few people are talking about nowadays, because you can look at the decays of quark interquark bound states, quarkonia. For example, if you are taking historically the rho meson, which is a bound state of up, enter, up, and down, enter, down, this is the flavor wave function in the quark model, then you can draw a diagram that the up quark and the enter up quark are proceeding from the initial state to the final state, and then you are generating a DD bar diquark system from the vacuum, and then this UD bar and DU bar are forming charged pions. And since the rho mass is larger than twice the pion mass, this decay mode happens kinematically. And since these quark lines from the initial state to the final state are not interrupted, continuous, this is called Zweig allowed, and this leads to a large decay width. By the way, who doesn't know who Zweig is? So this means you all know that the quark model has not only been introduced by Gell-Mann. Zweig has introduced this independently. He was not calling the quarks quarks, he was calling the quarks aces. And he also put in some additional ingredients into the quark picture. For example, the notion of Zweig allowed and quark and impossible Zweig forbidden decays. For example, if you impossible consider the analogous bound state out of charms and bottoms, then you would like to draw, for example, for the charm quarks, the same diagram. You are generating a DD bar from the vacuum. Then in the final end, you have charged D mesons. However, the mass of the J psi is smaller than twice of the D boson mass. So this decay is kinematically forbidden, which means that the Zweig allowed decay is not possible. And this is the reason why the J psi and the epsilon are very, very narrow resonances. Otherwise, it wouldn't have been that easy in experiment to discover these strong needles from the background, because this means if you are producing a J psi, then you see it. If you're producing an epsilon, then you see it, because these are very sharp peaks in the spectrum of the background. This is history, because already in the year 1964, these analyses have been done, these investigations have been done. Which means that the J psi impossible has to decay in a different way, because the J psi is not a stable bound state, of course. Either by photon exchange, it can decay into a charged lepton pair or also in a quark-interquark pair. But since this goes with the electromagnetic coupling, this is a small contribution to the decay width. So it means in non-relativistic QCD, I will finish this. Okay. You can perform this calculation in the same way as you're performing the calculation for positronium, which leads to the fact that you have the wave function describing the structure of charm, intercharm inside the J psi at the origin times the charm charge squared due to the photon coupling and some QED coupling in front. And this is a very small contribution, less than 1 MeV, compared to a 3 GeV mass of the J psi. So this is a very small contribution. And this is not the dominant decay. The dominant decay, of course, you could imagine then the J psi decays into two gluons. But the J psi is a spin one particle. Two gluons are two massless spin one particles. This decay mode is, because this decay mode is not possible due to the Young theorem, which can be proven by applying charge conjugation to the Feynman diagrams, and then you see that this decay cannot happen. So this means that the J psi cannot decay into two gluons. Okay, if it cannot decay into two gluons, it can decay into three gluons. Three gluons is possible. Then you are using, again, a factorization as before, because this I forgot to mention, in the non-relativistic approach, of course, you can see that you also have a factorization between the wave function of this bound state and the hard scattering process. So it means also some kind of factorization is at work here. And then for the decay into three gluons, you are approaching the same thing. The J psi is quite heavy because the charm quark mass is quite heavy, so that you are in the perturbative range. And in particular for the epsilon, this works. And this means that we can use perturbative calculations for these diagrams, mapped, of course, onto the quantum numbers of the J psi bound state. This is something that I don't want to tell you here in detail. The outcome of this calculation is just this expression. At this point, I'm always making a joke. The experimental observation of the J psi decay into three gluons is a proof that pi is unequal to 3, an approximation that is always made by, quite often made by engineers. So this is an experimental proof that pi is unequal to 3, but this is a joke, of course. This here simply means that in the total sum of all the diagrams, because you have to add all the permutations of the gluons, you have a strong cancellation from something of the order of 10 to something of the order of 1. And this is something which even furthermore suppresses this decay mode. And then you, again, in the non-relativistic approach, you have the wave function at the origin and the strong coupling constant at the typical scale, which is determined by the J psi or epsilon mass. And then you can also calculate, just one second, if you are calculating then, because you can obtain the wave function at the origin from other observables for J psi decays. And then you are calculating the decay widths into three gluons, and then you are getting something of the order of 50 or 40 keV compared to the quarkonium masses of 3 GeV or 5 GeV or 10 GeV for the J psi and the upsilon, which means that these are very narrow resonances, and the decay into three gluons is the dominant decay mode. Three gluons means three jets, so this means the J psi is observed to decay into three jets. And then you can, for the investigation of the jet profile, you have to investigate the Dahlitz density of this decay mode, which is the double differential decay width in terms of these rescaled energies X1 and X2 for two of the gluons. And of course, this expression has to be totally symmetric in X1, X2, and X3, because you have three identical particles in the final state. This decay mode also serves as a proof, an independent proof, that the gluon is color charged. Because assume that the gluon is an abelian gauge boson, then of course this diagram here exists, that of course, for example, a BB bar pair can annihilate into a quark-antiquark pair with strong couplings. But this here leads to the prediction that two jet final states are dominant. And this is not observed, because the dominance of three jet final states on the resonance is only observed, and this is a proof that the gluon cannot be an abelian gauge boson. This is an indirect proof that the gluon is a non-abelian gauge boson. And this is confirmed historically, these are old plots, from the experiment where the bottom quarks have been discovered. What is shown here is this differential cross-section with respect to several jet type parameters, like thrust, or the energy of the third parton, angular distribution, and things like that. The dashed line is the prediction of an abelian gluon with two jet final states. The full line is the prediction of the upsilon decays into three jets. The full dots are the experimental data, including the full QCD matrix element. And the open dots are measurements that you are performing if you are off the resonance. So this means you are just taking two jet final states if you are off the upsilon resonance. So this means off the resonance, you see with these open data points, two jet final states, of course. On the resonance, you only see three jet final states. This is an experimental proof that the J psi decays into three jets for all different angular distributions. But now one can also ask, yeah, but this is not really a proof of QCD, because it might be there's also a pure phase space effect, so that what you're seeing is the three particle phase space, and that you're not sensitive to the structure of the matrix element. So put the matrix element a constant and just integrate over the phase space, then you are getting this long dashed curve, and this disagrees with the data. So this means these data tell you, in addition, that you see the QCD matrix element, which means that you are seeing the effect of the partonic dynamics. And this is another big success of perturbative QCD. And with these words, I would like to finish this lecture, and I will come to the modern treatment of jets then tomorrow, in the first half of the lecture, or the first one-third, and the last part of the lecture will then be about effective field theories, a little bit. Thank you very much. Questions? I hope that you don't think that I was.
Yeah, so I have a question about the Juic separation, what you were talking about. Yeah. That is this that OZ rule, what you were talking about that separation of Juic decay allowed and not allowed?
I didn't get the word, what
you... The suppression you were talking about, that the decay of J psi, they are suppressed, the Juic suppression, Juic decay allowed or not?
Yeah.
In the previous, slide, yes.
This year.
That rho zero decay, that is...
Yeah, because this is a pure QED effect. and therefore it's small.
No, no, sir. I'm just asking, is that Zweig allowed decay?
Yeah. Ah, okay. Yeah.
Is that the same as that OZ rule? That means if I just omit one gluon line, then the decay will be suppressed or something like that. Is it the same as that?
Yeah, of course, because these are old. Because this is an old notation, of course, in modern times, of course, this notation has changed. But I think it's important to mention that, of course, this classification into large decay width and small decay width already existed in the 60s. And nowadays, of course, these refinements of enhanced and suppressed decays, of course, has been worked out in much more detail. And then, of course, many, many different aspects are playing a role. And therefore, of course, I don't know exactly what you are talking about, but I assume that this is one of these modern developments where you can explain some effects. But of course, this two-jet suppression has nothing to do with the suppression of the J-psi decay into muons, for example, in the quark-gluon plasma, because this is due to the big heating, which is resolving all these bound states, and therefore, of course, these J-psi bound states are not stable in the quark-gluon plasma, for example. Yeah.
Okay,
so it means some of these statements also depend on your environment, but here it's just a counting of the quantum numbers, kinematics, and the basic theory that you are starting with, like QCD or QED. And then it's an outcome that these two jet final states are suppressed on resonance.
And I have another question about the definition of the Z. So we are defining that the PT should be less than equal to 500 MeV.
The PT inside the jet. Yeah.
PT, so how we define that?
No. I will come to this later. Of course, the definition of the jet depends on which cuts you are imposing, because in principle in the final state. So it means 500 MeV PT is the rough order of magnitude which you can minimally introduce as the PT inside a jet. If you are cutting stronger, then you are getting non-perturbative, but you can in principle also apply some looser cuts, and then you have wider jet definitions. And this for example, is also reflected. Sorry, this is the connection. This was here. By the y dependence of the fraction of these two jets. Y is nothing else than a parameter which tells you how wide your individual jets are. And this means if these individual jets are wide, then you have the dominance of two jet configurations. If the y becomes smaller and the jet definition becomes narrower, then you are resolving more of the structure inside the sodonic. Then you are resolving much more of the structure inside the hadronic final state, and therefore the three-jet rate is increasing. But all these experimental data are data to the same set of events. So the interpretation is different because you are applying a different cut on the size of the jets.
Does this cut come from how much collimated my jet should be or something like that?
Yeah, right. Because these cuts, of course, are introduced in such a way that first this cut should allow that perturbation theory is reliable.
Okay.
So there is a minimal cut below which you cannot trust impulse with the perturbative expansion. And then, of course, if you are simulating, for example, the jets in the event generators, then, of course, you are taking, into account what we are calling a shower, the multiple radiation of gluons, which are then combined into a single jet. Yeah. So it means then you're radiating impossible all the gluons all the time, thousands of gluons, until the energy of each of the parton is crossing some threshold that you have to define in these generators, which is roughly 1 GeV, and then you are hadronizing them. Yeah, this is the procedure, the basic idea of all these event generators. And in this way, you are getting a proper description of the experimental profile. You have to tune some parameters for the hadronization, which also imposes uncertainties, but you are getting a proper description of the experimental profile that you can see in your detector.
So more and more PT range, I will have more error rule defining it as jet or something like that.
Yeah, right. So it means the stronger you are cutting, the more structure you observe also in experiment. And the crucial point, because therefore this question is quite important, the crucial point is that the Y behavior agrees with the prediction. This also tells you something very non-trivial. This, because these Y cuts are introduced at the partonic level in your calculation. In experiments, the Y cuts are introduced at the hadronic level. Both of these predictions in terms of the shapes agree, which tells you that the perturbative partonic calculation is in line with the distributions that you observe at the hadronic level in experiment. And this is a non-trivial statement.
Thank you.
In the jet multiplicity part, is it n equals to zero is a possibility?
This was exactly the point that I was stumbling on when I wrote down. Yes, of course, n equals to zero is not sensitive to alpha s in leading order because this was too fast. So this is the reason why I'm giving the index n plus one, n plus two, because at leading order, of course, you are producing the two jets from a from some weak coupling. You don't have any alpha s. So n equals to zero means the two jet fraction, which means this curve here, which is the dominant one at large y cut. And then also this two-jet fraction has a perturbative expansion. So you are adding higher orders, which are depending on alpha s, because in the final end, of course, if you would not impose any jet cut, because you're using the same calculation, of course, you have to reproduce these results for the inclusive cross-section. When y cut is very large in infinity, then you don't have any distinction between the jets. And then, of course, you are integrating out the full cross-section, then you have to reproduce the impossible, the full inclusive cross-section of hadrons. And this is also the reason why for large Y-cut, the two-jet fraction approaches one. Yeah, this is the inclusive cross-section that here you are starting with. And then you are cutting into the phase space, and then you are decreasing the two-jet fraction because you are resolving jet configurations where you have a third separate jet or a fourth separate jet up to five jets. And I forgot to mention, all these curves are at least next to leading order predictions. And for the two jet rate and for the three jet rate, meanwhile, also next to next leading order predictions. And the higher the perturbative order, the better the agreement with the experimental data became.
Another question is, you mentioned flux tubes with small PT, they break up. Can you explain why?
This means if you are producing these, this quark antiquark pair. So this means you have the two protons, which are then colliding. By the way, just to make this clear, all these hard scattering processes are happening inside the proton, not outside. Everything that we are calculating in the parton picture happens inside the proton. And then, of course, inside the proton, you have weakly interacting particles if you are at small distances, large energy scales, and then some particles are struck out. So this means, just one second. What was your question? Sorry.
Small PT, flux tube with small PT, they break up.
Right. So this means then you are producing a highly energetic quark-antiquark pair. So here you have the quark, here you have the antiquark. These two quarks are still communicating to each other because they are produced in a single point, and then, of course, you have all the gluon field lines connecting these quarks. Yeah? But the gluon field lines are also confined. This can be proven on lattice calculations and has been proven that you are building up a tube between this quark-antiquark pair, and outside of this flux tube, you don't feel nearly anything left over from the strong interaction. Apart, if you're getting close to the flux tube, of course, you feel the strong interactions. This is the reason why protons and neutrons are binding. So, and then these are traveling apart. So the next step is that they are far apart. You still have this flux tube from both sides. But if you are traveling apart, then the energy inside this flux tube becomes larger and larger. Yeah, because the QCD potential rises at large distances. And then it becomes more energetic, less energetic, so this means this is the antiquark, if you're producing antiquark quark state from the vacuum, and then the flux tube breaks up. And this is the, because this is the less energetic state, so that in this, because at that moment, of course, you have two mesons which are traveling apart. But this here is still traveling with high momentum, And these are traveling with a small momentum. So there's a discrepancy. So it means the flux tube stretches again until it reaches a point where quark-antiquark pairs produce out of the vacuum, and then the flux tube impulse breaks up again. And this process happens until the relative moment between the quark and antiquark pair is small, so that they are forming a stable bound state. And then these bound states are dominantly then pions, because these are light, because these are the lightest mesons that we know, and there's a reason why they are the lightest meson, and also some other hadrons concerning the experimental environment and also the probabilities to produce these hadrons. And this is the intuitive picture that they had at that time, why bunches of hadrons are forming, and why these hadrons are not only a single one for each parton, but really a bunch of hadrons for each parton. And this intuitive picture has been confirmed by a lot of, partially confirmed by a lot of calculations on the lattice, and also by looking at more details in all these event generators, because event generators, including showering and hadronization effects, are based on this idea, that this is what happens microscopically, why you see many, many hadrons in the final state then. Does this answer your question?
Yeah, but then why not high PT particles will do the same thing?
The first thing is that this happens quite fast. So it means this quark-antiquark system reaches the distance of the size of a hadron very fast. Then the first breakup starts. Then the second breakup starts. This is because this is a very fast process, and in this because this means that the jet is forming immediately after the collision, and this is the reason why the jet still contains a lot of information about the original hard scattering process. And in this way, of course, it's a heuristic picture. There's no mathematical proof that this is the right one, but the picture works, and we are physicists. So it means if something works, then we continue using that. As for example, some observables, you can use also the old methods of the 60s, retro theories, S-matrix methods, and things like that. For certain observables, they still work, and of course, then these pictures are used. Or for example, one example is also to use current algebra of the 60s, where you find an explanation why the pion is so light, because the pion is a pseudo-Goldstone boson, and therefore the pion is that much lighter than all the other hadronic bound states. And this is the basis of what we are calling chiral perturbation theory. It's a different field in the field of strong interactions, where you can treat the scattering of pions and kaons properly. And this is important, for example, if you want to build up a proper interpretation of what you are simulating on lattice calculations, for example. Or if you want to study some low-energy QCD issues concerning pions and kaons. And this means there are a lot of different regions in strong interactions, and I was focusing in this lecture just on the perturbative QCD part.
How did you conclude that gluon is a SU3 gauge boson from that plot? I missed that.
Can you repeat the
question? How did you conclude that gluon is a SU3 gauge boson from that plot?
Okay. So this I did not explain in detail, but these energy fractions here have some perturbative expansion, Taylor coefficients, which means these Taylor coefficients here depend on the color charge of the gluon and of the quarks. So it means color charges are contained in these expansion coefficients. If you have accurate measurements, then you are sensitive to higher and higher orders in the perturbative expansion. Although the perturbative expansion is a converging zero, at least the first orders are converging, the higher the accuracy, the more of these higher order effects you see, and the more sensitive you are coming to the color structures of these Taylor coefficients. Which means if you're making a global fit to all these event, to all these jet profiles in the final state, jet fractions, angular distributions, everything, then you make a global fit using the theoretical calculations for all these observables, and keep these two color factors, these three color factors, CF, TR, and CA, as being arbitrary. And these are the parameters that you want to fit. Yeah? And then you are getting a global fit, which is this yellow ellipse. And then you are putting the predictions of all these non-abelian engaged groups into this plot. And then you see that only the SU3 is a perfect prediction, which is inside this yellow ellipse, which is favored by the global fit of the experimental data. So the analysis behind that is quite involved, because you have to include many, many different jet fractions and jet profiles and things like that. Therefore, this is a huge analysis which is behind that plot. But the important thing for a theorist is always just the outcome of these analysis on the experimental side. So it means that this is really one of the most powerful confirmations of QCD. And as far as I remember, this analysis has mainly been made by Günter De Sartori from Zurich. He is now professor at the Experimental Institute at the ETH. And he got famous for this plot. And this is also some other important point, because you have to get the idea to do this analysis. So it means, impossible, if you have the full theoretical calculations and you have the experimental data, of course, this impossible doesn't help much if there's not some body who has the crucial ideas which analysis are impossible relevant. And this was really a crucial idea to try to fit the color factors, which are hidden in the Taylor coefficients.
You
have a microphone.
Yes. You were talking towards the last plot, you were saying that some of them, the two jet processes dominated by off resonance data points. What does that mean? Okay. Is that non-bound states which have contributed?
Yeah. So this simply means first, these are data from an E plus E minus collider. And then you are producing a heavy quark anti-quark pair, but of course you are also producing all the light quarks. So this is the usual environment in E plus E minus. Now, if you are plotting this as a function of the energy, then of course you have the decreasing cross-section of two jet final states. And then at the mass of about 3 GeV, suddenly you have a sharp peak on top of the background. And this here is the J-Psi peak. This is very narrow, it's a needle, so it means if you're looking into the particle data booklet at all these plots, you always find the J-Psi peak as being a single line in the spectrum. And this means you have to sit in the energy range of that small decay width of the J-Psi to be on resonance. And the off-resonance part is, of course, measuring the continuum, where, of course, you have two jet events. So this means this dashed line is the old prediction of these two jet final states in E plus and minus. The modern predictions are, of course, more precise, and the agreement between the data and the theory is much more better than it is visible here in this plot. But the crucial point was this full line, because this full line was really the distribution measured in a very small region around the central value of the resonance. So that you are sure, because this here is a huge peak. So it means you are getting a huge number of J-psis, so that the two jet background is negligible. All the jet profiles are really dominated by events which are sitting somewhere here at the upper part of this resonance. And then you were dominated by three jet final states. Of course, in the experimental environment, you have a small contamination of two jet final states. But the three jet final states are dominant, and I would like to draw your attention that this is a normalized plot. So it means in practical numbers, if you are rescaling to the total number of events, of course, you are seeing the differences between the three jet rate and the two jet rate of resonance. Yeah? So this means that the jet profile is really different if you are sitting in this region or this region. There, the jet profile is similar compared to this small region around the pole of the resonance. And this is a crucial discrimination, because this tells you that also this prediction is right, that QCD controls the continuum, And QCD also controls the properties of the Jape psi peak. The treatment of the Jape psi peak itself, of course, is a bit more tricky because, you have seen the wave function at the origin, which contributes to this decay width. This is, of course, non-perturbative. This has to be fitted from data. My laptop doesn't work again, but fortunately at the end. Any more questions? Doesn't seem to be the case, so thank you very much.